JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for July the 28th. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded mixed against the other major currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian session on Wednesday. It gained against NZD, AUD and CAD, while it underperformed versus JPY, GBP, the Euro and the Swiss franc in that order. The strengthening of the Japanese yen, combined with the weakening of the risk-linked Aussie, Kiwi and Loonie, suggests that markets traded in a risk-off fashion yesterday and today in Asia. Indeed, looking at the performance in the equity world, we see that major EU and US indices were a sea of red, with the negative sentiment easing somewhat today. Although Japan's Nikkei 225 and China's Shanghai Composite slid, Hong Kong's Hang Seng and South Korea's KO SPI traded in the green. The slide in European and US equities followed the tumble in Asia on Tuesday morning and may have been the result of continuous worries over Chinese government regulations in the education, property and tech sectors. However, apart from the tighter regulations in China, investors may have refrained from increasing their risk exposure, also due to the FOMC decision scheduled to become public later today. At its latest meeting, the committee kept its policy unchanged, but signaled that interest rates are likely to start rising in 2023. Since then, we've heard the individual views of several policymakers, with some of them supporting that interest rates should even start rising during 2022, and others arguing against withdrawing monetary policy support too soon. The divided Fed was also reflected in the minutes of the gathering, with various participants feeling that the conditions for reducing their asset purchases would be met somewhat earlier than they had anticipated, while others saw a less clear signal from incoming data and suggested a patient approach to any policy change. Overall, though, they generally agreed that it is important to be well positioned to reduce their pace of the pace of their asset purchases in case there is faster than anticipated progress towards the committee's goals. Now, on top of that, both the headline and core CPIs for June accelerated by more than anticipated, with the headline rate rising to a 13-year high, and the core one hitting its highest level since November 1991. This may have added to concerns that the inflation spike may eventually not be due to transitory factors. And even Fed Chair Powell, who said that the economy is still ways off from desired levels, failed to convince market participants that it will take long before they start normalizing their monetary policy. According to the Fed Fund futures, investors are now fully pricing in the first rate increase to happen in April 2023, and thereby they may be interesting to see whether their bets are correct. They may also be eager to find out when officials are planning to start scaling back their quantitative easing purchases. We believe that the Fed will discuss inflation and perhaps acknowledge that the surge in prices may not be transitory after all. We also believe that due to the skyrocketing inflation, there may be a discussion over when to start scaling back their quantitative easing purchases. The risk to that view is taking a more cautious approach due to the fast spreading Delta variant of the coronavirus, posing fresh risks to the economic recovery. However, with the conference board consumer sentiment index for July rising to a new 17-month high, we see decent chances for the committee to add a hawkish flavor to its in its statement. A hawkish message may allow the US dollar to trade higher and equities to correct lower. Now, flying from the US to Australia overnight, we got the nation's CPIs for the second quarter. The headline rate skyrocketed to 3.8% year over year from 1.1%, overcoming the upper bound of the RBA's target range of 2 to 3%. However, the trimmed mean rate, although it rose as well, stayed below the lower end of that target range. The actual numbers matched the market forecasts, and the Aussie did not react at the time of the release, as this keeps expectations around the RBA's future plans unchanged. At this month's gathering, RBA officials announced that they will proceed with more bond purchases beyond September, and also said that they are planning to keep rates at current levels until 2024. So with that in mind, even if market sentiment rebounds, we believe that the Aussie is likely to perform poorer than its other risk-linked counterparts, especially the Kiwi, the central bank of which is expected to push the hike button very soon, perhaps as early as next month. It could underperform against the greenback as well if we do get a hawkish message by the Fed today. Later in the day, ahead of the Fed decision, we get more CPI data, this time from Canada and for the month of June. Here, both the headline and core rates are forecast to have declined to 3.2% and 2.4% year-over-year from 3.6% and 2.8% respectively. At its latest meeting, the Bank of Canada appeared less hawkish than expected, saying that they continue to see the output gap closing in the second half of 2022, which suggests that their expectations over when they may start raising interest rates have not come forth. With that in mind, slowing inflation is likely to add credence to the view that the prior surge was due to transitory factors and may prompt cut traders to reduce their hike bets even further. This is likely to keep the loonie underselling interest, especially against the greenback, in case the Fed sounds hawkish tonight. Now, as for the rest of today's events, apart from the Fed decision and Canada CPIs, the only other release worth mentioning on today's agenda is the Energy Information Administration report on crude oil inventories for last week. Expectations are for a 2.928 million barrels slide after a 2.108 million barrels increase the week before. That said, bearing in mind that the American Petroleum Institute report yesterday reported a slide of 4.728 million, we would consider the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration number as tilted to the downside. As for tonight, during the Asian session Thursday, we have New Zealand's ANZ Business Confidence Index for July, but no forecast is currently available. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.